I decided to do a little follow-up video to the one in the USSR that I did last night. There were a couple of comments, some questions some of you posted, and I wanted to address a couple of those things, and also some of the things that I forgot to mention. One question was, how did I know that the system was full of lies? How did I know that my father, who talked about these things quietly in our kitchen with his friends and family, how did I know that he was right and the system was in fact rotten and broken? Well, several things. Well, I guess you tend to trust your parents, and I certainly did my father. I had no reason to suspect that he was lying to me about life being crappier than it could have been, I shared that feeling. But there were also other things that were more observable or objective, if you will. Say, for example, I don't know, everybody knew that, well, okay, there were castes in society, and there was a very clear caste called the Communist Party, and there were a couple of things known, very well known, about this clique, about this caste. If you wanted to advance materially, right, you had to join the Communist Party. You had to make a career, like, you know, how people make careers, in something like a U.S. society, right? You go and study, you master a trade, a profession, you become good and proficient at something, you get a job, you get a better job, you advance, you start out as a lowly employee, you make yourself, you know, you make your way up the ladder to some middle management position, then maybe top management, whatever. Or, you know, you're an entrepreneur. But entrepreneurship was out of the question. Like I said, there was no private production. There pretty much was no private economy in the USSR. But there was a career ladder that you could climb. But it was kind of weird because it was sort of a nested career situation or a parallel career situation. You had to make a career in the Communist Party. And that was a parallel existence. You had to join the party. You had to participate in their activities, committee meetings, vote, you know, get voted on, probably get elected to some kind of local council of the Communist Party, and you advanced like that. And with that came a career in the real world. You would get appointed, you know, a director of a plant or a director of some kind of office, and that was a prerequisite. Pretty much no non-Communist Party members ever made it high in the command positions, in terms of the command positions in the economy. And everybody knew that. Like, that, you know, if you're not a Communist Party member, it's not going to happen. If you want to be a boss, if you want to make it, if you want to get a bigger flat, if you want to get a bigger salary, if you want to get a car, like state-provided car, many times with a chauffeur, you had to be a Communist Party member. That was absolutely common knowledge. Now, it was also common knowledge, at least among the people, the kind of people that sort of hang around my father, that you had to be an SOB to join the Communist Party, because you would have to habitually lie. You would have to play the stupid game of believing in the communist ideology. So they kept up the appearances of believing in the ideology. Nobody believed in anything, with some exceptions that I think were pretty rare. But by and large, people knew that all this, you know, triumph of socialism all over the globe and, you know, liberating the workers all over the globe, that was all crap. Nobody studied Lenin or Marx or, you know, let alone believed in that. Nobody read that crap. You were sort of supposed to. You were supposed to take exams in school. Whatever you studied in college, you had to take exams on, like, communist ideology and philosophy. And the joke that I remember that my father told many times was, when you're looking for a black cat in a dark room, that's philosophy. When you're looking for a black cat in a dark room when the cat is not in the room, that's dialectical philosophy. And when you're looking for a black cat in a dark room and the cat is not in the room, but from time to time you shout that you found it, that's the Marxist-Leninist philosophy. Everybody knew that crap. Like, you couldn't seriously read and believe it, but you had to take tests. as if you did. So that alone, think about it. You're 20, 21, and you're taking exams and crap that you know you don't believe, but you have to pretend like you do. So that, I think that, you know, that kind of, that's a filter that allows people to self-select by their, you know, psychopathy, I guess, you know, by their high tolerance for unconscionable and deceitful behavior. People who were okay with that, because they, the reward that they saw, the prize that they were willing to fight for, was, you know, too desirable, those people went and joined the Communist Party. Very, very few, I would say single digits in terms of percentage, joined the Communist Party because they believed in something. Some did, certainly did, but very few, right? So all the communists that my dad knew were just career psychopaths, really. They were willing to lie and be lied to and be deceitful in order to progress and, you know, advance in their careers. And then you had to, and the Communist Party actually ran everything, meaning, you know, at every plant, every factory, there was a Communist Party committee. And all the big bosses, all the big shots in that place were members of that committee, and they would have their meetings, and they would have their decisions, and it would have, you know, the outward appearance of some kind of democracy sometimes, like they would vote for things, but all the important decisions were rendered by the bosses, and they, you know, people were told, the rank and file members were told how to vote very, very clearly. Another thing about voting, like that, a joke that illustrates how that voting worked, was a joke about Brezhnev. Like Brezhnev is sitting on election day in Soviet Union. Remember, they had elections, right? People went to the voting booths, allegedly. And there were elections, and the ballots were cast, and they were counted, and the results were announced. So the joke goes like this. Brezhnev is sitting in his Kremlin office, all fidgety and, you know, nervous. It's an election night, and his secretary, or whatever, comes in and says, Mr. Secretary General, or Tavarish Secretary General, Comrade Secretary General, I have bad news and good news. Brezhnev says, okay, give me the bad news first. He said, well, your opponent got 65% of the vote. Oh my God, no. What's the good news? Well, the good news is that you got 92. So yeah, so the Communist Party had this parallel, like, like blood circulation and lymph circulation, right? It had a parallel circulation system that really ran everything. And kind of like during the World War II, they had the political officers, the Politruk, right, who was nominally second in command with every regiment. There was a political officer who was a party man. He was not an army man. He was a party man. And he had the ultimate authority. He could depose the commander. He could shoot the commander, which they, you know, many of them did. He was really calling the shots. He was sort of the gray shadow cardinal of every single regiment, brigade or army or whatever. So that system existed, that parallel system that really ran everything, and the system that was the Communist Party, really existed everywhere that people worked. And people who were not party members, of course, recognized that, and they saw it for what it was. It was basically a mafia running things. And it was a certain mafia. You could join the mafia, but you would have to sell your soul. And obviously people were not willing to do that. And I remember growing up, you know, all over the place you had those posters and the unbreakable bloc of communists and the non-party members. Блок коммунистов и без партий, right? And I was, or the party and the people are one. The party and the people are one was a big one. All over the place. The party and the people are one. And I'm like, okay, well, if the party is good, then are we the party or are we the people? And I asked my dad, are we the party or are we the people? He said, oh, we're the people. Okay, why aren't we the party? And I don't remember what that answer, but he didn't have a very good answer. I was like seven. So yeah, people recognized that universal fact and they talked about it. And there was no way to unknow what you know. So, you know, inevitably people kind of, there were people who were not Communist Party members who would defend the system. Notably, my dad's half-sister and her husband, her entire family, they were actually pro-Soviet. And the phrase about them in our household was, "But I like it about the system." Like whenever Dad would bring something up at a family gathering or something, they would always defend, like a reflect. What's the word I'm looking for? Like reflexive status, if you will, reflexive pro-Soviet status. My dad was reflexively anti-Soviet, and but some people were reflexively pro. I don't have an explanation for that. There's a number of explanations for that, I guess. You know, you fill in the blanks yourselves. So yeah, and also the media, like the newspapers and the TV stations, of which we had, I think, three. One was local, Leningrad, and two were Channel 1 and Channel 2. And they all, you know, broadcast the same crap. But, you know, what they wrote and what they said on TV was always this... we're marching onward to the victory of socialism. Everything's great. Nothing bad ever happened. My dad used to joke that hurricanes and earthquakes stop at the borders of the Soviet Union. Nothing ever got reported. No natural disasters, no nothing. And some unnatural disasters, too. Like Janet Napolitano would say, man-made disasters. Like the Chernobyl is a good example. Chernobyl, that was already Gorbachev's time. That was 1986, if I'm not mistaken. And they lied about it in the media for days, not weeks, that, you know, it wasn't a big deal. You know, people were dying. Those deaths were not being reported, which I guess sort of, you know, the degree to which that was pervasive and part of the DNA of that society and that state apparatus and the media, which is really, you know, very, very close to the state. It's like very close to the skin. Became evident when the Kursk submarine sank. Was it 2000, 2001? When Putin was already, I think it was the year 2000, Putin was already president of Russia. And they lied about it 2 to 3 days. They would give conflicting and untrue reports of what was going on. Like the sub had already sunk and they were saying, no, they're still there. We're monitoring it. Everything's under control. The seamen are alive inside. We could hear them, you know, hammering onto the hull, through the hull, sending a signal, but when they were already dead, it was actually later documented that they were dead by that time. So, you know, a lot of those reports were untrue. So, you know, seeing that, seeing the TV, you know, knowing what everybody around you knows and talking about, you know, what everybody around you talks about, yeah, I guess, you know, it was not hard to be convinced that it was all a thin veil of lies. Not one word coming out of the state was true. The other thing, state was not only deceitful, it was also vicious. Every small bureaucrat, anywhere, really. I told that story about my mom trying to get registration with my dad in their flat where I grew up and lived for the first 16 years of my life until we moved out in 1991. I think it was 1991. Yeah, they were vicious bastards. They would exploit their position of power. Like, they didn't have much more than you would in terms of material possessions, but they had power over you. So when you needed a piece of paper, every fucking thing you needed a piece of paper for. You needed to go to this, you know, state office, and stand in line in a crappy room, and come to the counter and bend down to the window and ask for a piece of paper. Do, you know, minute things, every single thing you required a piece of paper, and then they would not give it to you, and they would say come back later, or you're lacking this document, or lacking that document. They were just acting as vicious bastards, power hungry sons of bitches. So that sort of didn't add to the state's credibility, because you associated the state with those people, because that was your interaction with the state. So your interaction with the Soviet Union as a state or as a concept was at work with the communists, with your bosses, you know, and the way all of those decisions were made at work and how idiotic things were much of the time, if not most of the time, over there. So that was your interaction with the state. That was your impression of the state. And also every public place, like public place is a very mild term, every state office, small or big, you were nothing. You would come in there and you were nothing. And they would make it very clear that you are nothing. As an individual, individuals don't matter. Individuals don't matter. Only the collective matters. Only the country matters. And we are the country, see? And you're not. So, you know, the sum of all those interactions, I guess, imprinted on those of us who are capable of, you know, thinking about things, very early on, that this place was a vicious, vicious place. And it was a machine that cared nothing about you and would, in fact, do bad things to you. Or at the very least, would keep you down so you know your place. Now, another comment, you know, one of my subscribers left about how, you know, the conditions I'm describing are sort of similar to what he experienced as a child growing up in Chisinau. Chisinau is the capital of Moldova, now Republic of Moldova. But it's still, my impression is still that it's still a very crappy place. It's actually run by communists. They do have elections there and stuff, but it's run by the alumni of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union, Moldova branch. And it's a crappy, crappy place. Probably the crappiest, you know, among the ex-USSR republics. But anyway, yeah, okay, Chisinau was a capital city in a Soviet republic. But there were places where the majority of the country lived. And the majority would be, what, 180 million, 200 million before the Soviet Union broke up? Maybe more than 200 million people? I don't know. Russia now is slightly over 140 million, so if you add Kazakhstan and Ukraine and all those other republics, albeit smaller, you would probably get close to 200 million people. Because Russia is depopulating, it's not growing in population. Russia's population is shrinking. So there were places where the majority of places, where the majority of people lived much, much worse. And a couple of hours drive from St. Petersburg, from Leningrad, there's a city of Pskov. No, maybe not a couple of hours, maybe 3 hours, 4 hours. It's not too far, put it that way. It's not too far. It's towards Estonia. So west and south of Leningrad. Near the city of Pskov was a smaller town of Porchov. And near the town of Porchov was a village. I forget what, I never knew what it was called. I was never told that. And one time, a few years ago, I was in Russia on a business trip, and I was staying, as I always do, with my in-laws. And I was having another one of those long conversations with my mother-in-law about the past. And she was telling me her story, how she was growing up in that village. Now, the village had been converted to kolkhoz, the collective farm. And her dad was actually the chairman or the director of that collective farm. And he was a believer. He was a believer in terms of, you know, the kind of communist that he was. He wanted to do good. He wanted to help this wonderful movement towards the light, towards progress for all working people of the earth. And he ran this collective farm. Now, what was a collective farm? Collective farm was formed by the Soviet authorities confiscating the crap out of everybody, putting them, you know, forcing them onto one plot of land, confiscating their cattle, confiscating their land, and saying, now you're farming collectively, you're growing this wheat for us, and they would give them plans every year, and you were supposed to fulfill. Now, weather can interfere, right? You know, you can have crop failures and stuff. So the directors of those farms always lived under this sword of Damocles, you know, in fear of not meeting the quota for, like, grain, milk. But the thing about this was people lived as virtual serfs in those farms. They were not able to leave. Now, one thing you have to understand about the Soviet Union, there was no freedom of movement. You lived where the state told you you could live. Or sometimes you lived where the state put you. The story about my mom's registration, well, you know, if she didn't eventually get that registration, then, you know, she would have been in trouble. Because she can't stay there. She's not registered. Where does she go? Well, she moved back to, like, Volgograd, where she came from. graduates from universities and colleges were told by the state, they were given jobs and not apprenticeships, but like internships and jobs by the state. They were told it was called distribution. Distribution. You would stand in line, get your ticket, and the ticket would said where you work, what you do, and how much you get paid. So anyway, those people in the collective farms, they couldn't leave. Their passports were confiscated from them. They couldn't get them. And without the passport, you can't move about the country. Ihre Papieren bitte? Aber ohne bitte? You can't move. So they were tied to that land. Everything was taken from them. The conditions were horrible. My mother-in-law was growing up in a hut with a dirt floor. Okay? And there was this big oven, wood-burning oven, that would serve as a cooking device and the heating device for the entire house. There was a dirt floor. They were actually allowed to keep one cow, and they kept it in, like, you know, right outside the house, sort of in a covered shed right outside the house. But that was it. They were the exception. People weren't allowed to keep cattle, because if you keep cattle, you're becoming a little bit too independent, right? Because you can milk the cow for milk, or you can kill the cow for beef and stuff like that. They also kept a pig or two. So they were enormously wealthy for that village, but they were still dirt poor, literally dirt poor. And the stories that she told me made me cry. I actually had tears in my eyes listening to her, because I realized how the state raped millions of people, stripped them of their property, stripped them of their pride, had them, would stick them on this land and work them without letting them leave that plot of land, and people drank. Well, what else are you gonna do? There was no motivation, like the incentive problem. You bet. People just didn't care. They live like serfs. They live in dirt, in complete shit. No matter what they do, that's not gonna change. They can't even leave. They can't go anywhere. So why the fuck work? And my wife's grandfather, poor grandfather, was trying to, get them to work, coerce them, nudge them, because he had to meet that quota. People would just drink themselves to death, literally to death, generation after generation. That lasted for decades, since the 30s, okay? And my mother-in-law was growing up in the 50s. That's how it was. It's serfdom. It's actually, serfdom, slavery. There's no other term for it. So, and a lot of people lived like that. A lot of people lived in the village until, like, 70s, early to mid-70s, people couldn't leave. Again, their passports were kept away from them. And that only started happening, that only started changing in the 70s, where people were, finally able to move and, go to school in a bigger town and look for employment opportunities. Distribution opportunities, job distribution opportunities in bigger town. That's how my mother-in-law came to live in Leningrad. She's not born in Leningrad. Like my wife's father was born there. I was born there. She was born there when they got married. But my mother-in-law was from a village. She was a country girl, a village girl. Okay. Also, the relative levels of prosperity actually differ. Like, there were some things that we could never get in Leningrad, although it was the second biggest city and the cultural capital of the country and whatnot. Like, certain type of chocolates, they were only available in Moscow. And my dad sometimes would go on business trips to Moscow, and he would stay in his cousin's, his half-sister? No, not half-sister, cousin. In his cousin's one-room apartment, he would sleep. She would make a bed for him on the kitchen floor, because there was only one room. I guess we would call it a studio. He would stay there, and he would bring back these chocolates. We thought they were very nice. It was called Inspiration. The brand was called Inspiration. I still remember. It was very nice. Also, same goes for chocolate bunnies. The manufacturing facility, the chocolate factory, that made those was in Moscow, and they would just never make it to Leningrad. And he would sometimes bring, around New Year's Eve time, typically when you would want the chocolate bunny, he would bring those chocolate bunnies, maybe a couple. So they were not available, and they were expensive. Okay. Somebody asked me whether there were waiting lists for certain goods. There were waiting lists for books. Okay. And that was a funny system because you had to bring in a certain number of kilos of scrap paper, and then in return for that, you would get like a ticket, a voucher, and that voucher gave you a place in the line, and that was many times a physical, well, not many times, all the time, a physical line that you had to stand sometimes overnight to be among the first lucky few who would make it to the doors of this particular bookstore that converted those vouchers to books. And those vouchers were not like money substitutes. They were placeholders for that line, right? So they bought you a place in the line. You would still have to pay for the books. Somebody asked me about war and whether we were scared of a nuclear conflict growing up. I wasn't scared. It was certainly, in the background. It was being talked about how the imperialist U.S. Was just about to destroy the good people of the Earth who just happened to live in the Soviet bloc. And that there would be nuclear annihilation, but only the vigilant and brave Soviet army and the vigilant leaders of the Communist Party were keeping us from being destroyed by the evil US. But we were not scared. I don't remember that being like a factor of life. We did have like paramilitary training in school. We were taught how to, strip field and assemble an AK-47. I never fired one. I think I only saw one once, so it was sort of winding down by the time I got to be that age, 15. But movies were definitely propagandistic, like through and through. The U.S. was the big evil. Every single evil that the Soviet characters in the movies encountered was backed, inspired, or backed directly. Paid for and managed by the US. All the evils perpetrated were always perpetrated against good people, either the Soviet citizens or socialists in other countries, and it was always the evil hand of Washington behind it. And when somebody keeps telling you that something's evil, something's evil, something's evil, you will, as a kid especially, you will eventually tend to believe that the opposite is true. Forbidden fruit and stuff like that. I made a mistake. We actually did have a music playing device. We had a record player. The old and crappy one we had until I was 7 or 8. And then we got a better one. It actually had decent sound and, it drove pretty decent sized speakers and you could listen to the music loud. So you would play vinyl records. Some kids' records when I was little, Arkady Raikin, if that's something you know about, somebody that you know about, and also Vysotsky, obviously. And then later, we started getting pirated vinyl discs of like Deep Purple, Led Zeppelin. Well, my brother was really into Deep Purple. I later got into Led Zeppelin when I was like 14, and I had a crap load of records and I listened to them all the time. But the thing about the record player, you can't move it from room to room. And the reason why the tape player, the cassette player, was such a big deal is because you could pick it up and take it into the kitchen while you're peeling your potatoes for the dinner or something. You could still listen to your Vysotsky songs. A couple of things I also wanted to share. One, my dad worked. My dad was a sports writer. He wrote about ice hockey. His passion was ice hockey. It's history, statistics. He wrote books, published reference literature with statistics on hockey every year in Leningrad. There was an international tournament taking place every April in Leningrad, sort of like the B teams tournament. And typically you have Czech Republic, Sweden, Finland, Russia, USSR, and then later Russia, and sometimes Canada come and play. And that was about a week before the World Championship. And some of the players were snatched from those B teams at the last moment and sent on to the World Championship to join the A team. So it's a pretty big deal. And I was learning English, and my father at one point said, "You know what? I want you to come along with me to work at that tournament as a translator." And after every game, you're supposed to have a post-game press conference where the coaches have to come in and answer the questions from the media. So he took me in there, and I looked ridiculous. I was 14. And I translated there. And my dad was astonished because he said, I always used to think that foreign coaches were idiots, complete idiots, because they would answer all of their questions with moronic, monosyllabic comments, like yes, no. And that was until you came in and started translating. I realized it wasn't the coaches, it was the translators. They didn't know what the fuck they were talking about. So anyway, it was very, very exciting because I also got to actually interact with Westerners, right? And I noticed very early on that you can actually tell a Westerner from a Soviet citizen. And yes, some of it has to do with how they were dressed. Like, for example, they had colors in their clothes. Soviet clothes didn't have colors, like red or like bright blue or no, gray, black, more gray, other kind of gray. It was pretty much a colorless society in terms of clothes. It was amazing, actually, thinking back right now. It was amazing. Colors were a big deal. Like, if you saw somebody in a brightly colored piece of clothing, you knew that that was important. Important. So yeah, you could tell a foreigner by the way they dress, but even without that, I knew just the way they held themselves, the way they conducted themselves, the way they looked around. They didn't look beaten down. They looked upright. They looked different. Okay. The way they would look at you, you know, in their eyes, you know right away, this is not a Soviet person. And I told my dad that. He was 15, I think. He said, what do you expect? They're free people. And I remember to the day, free people. I wish Dad was around. I mean, you know, the last 4 or 5 years I've been thinking a lot about freedom and what free people means, and I'm sure he would convert to libertarianism like this. He was a very smart man. He would see what I see. And it's just too bad that I can't talk to him about these things anymore. But I remember this comment, free people. Of course, everything's relative, but you know what I'm saying. And another thing I wanted to share was in 1991, like what happened was, you know, Yeltsin was positioning himself as an opposition to Gorbachev, and Gorbachev was sort of, you know, he initiated the glasnost and the perestroika in 1985, and things were sort of starting to go in a better direction, and people felt generally that this is good, we're on the cusp of something important here, maybe. And then the Soviet Union got dissolved. Was it before or after the coup? Anyway, in August 1991, what happened was the old Soviet bureaucrats, including, like, high-ranking army officials, the head of the KGB, some of the Politburo members, ex-members and stuff, they got together secretly behind the scenes, and they decided Gorbachev has to go. We have to revert back to the USSR. We were losing the USSR. This state is dying. This machine is dying. We need to keep it going, and for that we need to depose and get rid of Gorbachev. When they said, well, they had some army regiments loyal to them or something, and they Gorbachev was vacationing in a home somewhere in the mountains. They had that home surrounded, had the communications cut off. So they essentially put him under house arrest there, and then they grabbed control of TV. And it was August 19th, 1991, and suddenly all the TV programming stopped, and they started playing the Swan Lake, the ballet performance, all channels, all three of them. Same thing. And we felt, uh-oh, this is not good. And later that day, they appeared in front of the cameras and said, we are the State Emergency Committee, and we are telling you that we're stopping this nonsense. Gorbachev is destroying the country. We're taking it back. Gorbachev is under arrest. We're going to put things back in order. And the people said, no fucking way. And the people actually took to the streets. Moscow, Leningrad, people took to the streets. The next day, August 20th, there was, and I was in Leningrad, a girl from my class in school, she and I we went to the Palace Square in front of the Winter Palace, the Hermitage. Huge square. Various reports gave various accounts of how many people got there that day. I heard up to 400,000 people. It was packed. It was choked full of people. I wouldn't be surprised. It was definitely in the hundreds of thousands. And we were there. And the mayor of Leningrad, Sobchak, spoke. And he said, "We will not let this happen. We're not going back." And there were reports of tanks in the streets of Moscow. And the chief of the local army command spoke at that meeting and said there will be no army troops or tanks on the streets of Leningrad. It was an exciting, exciting time. And I remember feeling very distinctly, God, could this mean that we might actually have a normal country here? That we might actually get a normal country? And I was immensely proud of that country that day. That this is what I wanted. People taking to the streets said, fuck no, we're not going back. Fuck communists. We are not going back. Do whatever you want. And three people actually died in Moscow under those tanks. But it was a beautiful, beautiful moment. That was the high point of my emotional connection with Russia. That was the best the country has done, you know, to my liking, to my taste. It was all downhill from there. Or before. But that was pretty interesting. People taking to the street and saying, no, we're not living under you bastards anymore. You can go to hell. You can kill us if you want to, but you can't take us back. And the army, and that's very interesting. I think that speaks volumes about the nature of political power. The army, you know, the tank crews sitting on those tanks and, you know, looking out of those peepholes and hatches, people would ask them, so are you going to kill me, son? You know, older guy, let's ask a young soldier. So you're going to shoot at me, son, if they give you the order? And the army, the military people were so embarrassed. They said, no, of course not. What are you talking about? We're just here because, you know, whatever. We're keeping peace or something. You know, just relax, dude. People would challenge the military, and the military was embarrassed because they realized they were facing unarmed people. And they might be given an order to shoot at those unarmed people. And some of them definitely would have, but many would not. And I can clearly, you know, imagine how, if that started to happen, at least some of those soldiers would turn their arms against their officers and shoot them and join the people or something. So, yeah, the power is not written in stone. The political power is not written in stone. It's all opinion. People obey because they place legitimacy with the source of their orders. When people stop doing that, hopefully, the order based on political power and violence will collapse. Anyways, that's it for now.